Alright, so I guess I'm gonna kind of try to limit this to the discussion of the voting that's set for the 8th of November. Now we have several choices, and when I was looking through all of the book, there's a massive book that it shows up with, and one of the major issues was a tax on the rich. It was a tax on anybody 250,000 over. An extra 1% or 2% depending on how high you were. So what we're taking here is maybe the government would take 20,000 extra, 40,000 extra. Now in that leaflet, it also said that that would be money that is put into the market and used as a financial instrument in the financial markets. Okay, so I'm like, whoa! So now the money is actually an event for the government to use specifically in stocks, to buy stocks or indexes or ETFs, mutual funds. Okay. So that's what they're going to be using that money for. So it's kind of interesting. I'm like, well, when you look at it that way, it's like, well, chances are the same people, those 20, the ones that you took the 20,000 from, were going to do the same. So we need to look at how they are going to invest. So you have the government itself. Chances are the government will invest that 20,000 or that 40,000 extremely less volatility, in large companies, like not monopoly size companies, rather than the little tiny volatiles, the riskier companies that the average person is like, yeah, that sounds cool. You know, they're gonna make a new tennis shoe made out of acorns. Oh, that's fabulous! I'm investing in that company. You know, and so that guy who was going to take his 20,000 and he was going to invest that little company now is going to lose out. So if you vote for the tax to be given to the state, to the US government, that little acorn company that's going to make the tennis shoes is going to lose out. And so you're looking at the small volatile companies being kind of jammed down over the next 4 years. So they're not going to get that input. They're not going to have that free flow anymore. So it's going to actually hurt the economy. It's going to hurt the small businesses dramatically. So now when you have the big government, look at the big government as like the big blue, like the machine, the computer machine itself. It now has a brokerage firm. It now knows how to trade stocks. It goes out there and buys and sells stocks. And maybe it really likes it. You know what I'm saying? So we have to look at it as a feeder. Like it's like an octopus, a hungry octopus that just wants to keep doing it. It likes gambling there. It likes the, I'll call it gambling because I will always call it gambling. It likes it. And it doesn't want to lose its prowess there. They've gotten more and more into it through the years. More and more into it. Government has gotten more and more into trading on the financial markets. So that money is expressly set aside for trading. But now we have to think, what are they going to trade for? Chances are it will be the large companies. Okay, so we're looking at if you go for it and you say, yeah, take their 20 grand, take their 40 grand, take their 80 grand, you know, if they have that much that they're going to give to the extra tax, well, you can also look at those little tiny companies going, yipe, I don't get it. I'm lost. So for the small investors, the small investment companies, they're going to be injured dramatically. Okay, And yeah, that's what happens when you switch to big government. And big government has so much taxation. When it has so much taxation, it starts to be like, well, I don't want to say socialism, but yeah, it does start to switch to being a socialist society. I'm not completely opposed of it, but yet I am, because it does, you know, those small decisions, like maybe that guy, the guy with the 20,000, he was going to maybe donate it. Maybe he was going to actually donate it to, you know, the raccoons' village. I don't know, I don't care, but maybe he was going to keep it. Maybe he was just going to keep it in the bank. Maybe alternatively, he was going to spend it. He was actually going to increase the economy, make it a more buoyant consumerism event. He doesn't have that 20 grand any longer. He cannot make it a buoyant consumer event. So now we have the 20 grand heading over to the state, heading over to the big government, for them to play the market as they will. And chances are it will be in those big stocks. So that was one of the major things. So when you're looking at that 1% that the government might get extra from the rich, let's look at that again. Think about it. Think where that money's actually going to be spent with the government, and versus where it was going to be spent with the individual. Okay, so yell, tax the rich, but not for the government to play big blue on the financial markets. You know, I just think that's a lucrative grab. You know, they're kind of greedy for it. So now we're going to head back, and that will adversely affect small business. Okay, so now I'm going to head back to a few other issues that were on the ballot. One of the major issues had to do with schooling. It was very confusing. It was about the immersion schooling of the Spanish children, the Mexican children, versus non-immersion. Okay, now if you go with the immersion, which they've had for 20 years, the drama is, it's an isolatory event if you do not get it right away. Immersion is extremely difficult. It is like, here it is, here's the orange. And you have to say that, aranja, or whatever. Never, you're not supposed to ever say aranja in the class. The kid can only ever hear orange. So that's what they've been pushing, okay? So in a way, it's a disassociation with the Mexican language. And by that disassociation with the Mexican language, it's telling the Spanish children, the little Mexican kids, Mexican-American kids, it's telling them that there's actually something wrong with the Spanish language. That, you know, your heritage, your culture, just forget it. You know, so it's a low esteem. Do you understand? It's a low esteem builder for that little child. He actually has to go to school and feel flogged. He has to feel flogged that he speaks Spanish in the first place, because he did not get that immersion immediately. Okay. Now the other version we're talking about is, because that would be the continuance of what they've been doing to these little Spanish kids. Now, or Mexican kids. Okay. So now when the other version is to let them have time, a little bit more time to learn. And so it will be a joined Mexican-American speaking lingua class. So they can hear aranja and they can hear orange, all in the same lesson. You know what I'm saying? So instead, so it's taking that total immersion version away and allowing them to hear aranja, okay? So anyway, and I have a feeling that you know, they're not supposed to feel, the little kids are not supposed to feel like, hey, wrong. You're a bad human being because you were born speaking that language in a family that speaks that language. You're wrong. And I have a feeling that that's what the immersion tactics of the last 20 years have done to a lot of Mexican-American children and that have grown up. You know, they didn't catch it right away. Oh my gosh, they feel extra low self-esteem. You know, drop out of school. So we're trying to avoid this. Try to bolster them into school. Try to keep them there. Try to actually go, you know what, there's nothing wrong with your culture. There is nothing wrong with being a Mexican-American. There's nothing wrong with Mexico. You're not a bad human being because you were born in Mexico. And I have a feeling that's what goes on with immersion, with little kids. Now, an adult maybe can handle immersion. It's like, hey, I'm in France or I'm in Germany. I can handle immersion. But when it's a little child, it may really be like, well, there's something wrong that my mother and father speak Spanish. There is something wrong. We're bad people. We're lower class. We're lower on the totem pole. We're lower everything. We're just garbage. So you have to remember that esteem is missing. That little moment of esteem. Like, hey, you know, they have whatever. They have parades and they have this and they have that going on in the Mexican culture, but they're not allowed to even talk about it. It's just almost like forget it. So in an odd, weird way, I'm absolutely actually opposed to the immersion tactic on a little child. I think it's really terrible. Because we do have a lot of people that have just jumped over here and they live here now, and they're like, you know, these little kids are feeling like, well, lesser human beings, and then they go home and they, like, you know, are mean to their parents. Like, you're stupid, you don't know English. You know, so it creates a lot of rift. Very, very, very bad system. So we want actually a smoother transition to learning a language, not one that is so abrupt and so finger-pointy. Like, I'm point fingers at you because you didn't learn it fast enough, so you have to drop out and go join a gang. That's what's been going on. All right. So we have those two that I thought were the most important, and I don't know. That's it. And for some reason, they just want to dredge sand around where I live. And that's an odd thing. Odd way to spend money is dredging sand around. But I don't know. Or I don't really have an answer for that one. Aside from, I guess they're gonna dredge the sand around. The other version was to make the marinas more beautiful, and that obviously would bring in more consumerism and increase the rates of the marinas and the moorages. And I don't know, I guess those people don't care about the sand. I don't know, so maybe it's the sand people versus the marina people. So that was just like a local issue that was a little bit different. A little bit of expansionism fights and those types of things going on. And I guess they'll be resolved in time, not this election or another one, but when we're talking about expansionism, I guess meant like, you know, this quarry or whatever, you know, to dig out the quarry further to make residential area for people to live. Now, if that goes on, there's nothing wrong with that. But I have a feeling that to me is just, well, you didn't deal with what you had. You know, we have a lot already. We have a lot of space already that has just been dealt with badly. So why not update that? Update what you already have tapped into. Why don't you fix that? Make that beautiful before you move on. It's almost like you look at it like that. You're a seamstress and you sew blankets. Well, I just sew blankets. sew blankets bad quality, or do you sew blanket and really, really make a beautiful patchwork quilt before you go on to the next patchwork? The rapidity of going from I'm just sewing the blanket just to finish it as fast as possible without actually looking at what you actually did in the first place and making that beautiful, that's the problem. They have not spruced up what we already have enough. Okay? Yeah. Any hoot, that's it. That's it. That's all I have. Yeah.